Good morning students. Today it is lecture 12 under thermal properties of matter. Concept of specific heat as well as a thermal capacity, and we have learned two definitions, one based on thermal capacity along and also specific heat, right? Today let me just glance the one specific heat and also thermal capacity. Today let us go for some more important points under specific heat capacity. Okay, so yesterday we have learned the one definition of thermal capacity: the amount of heat required to raise the whole body by 1 kg, that is whole body, through 1 degree centigrade. So you are raising the temperature by 1 degree centigrade, so you are heating whole body. So the amount of heat required to raise the temperature of whole body through 1 degree centigrade is called thermal capacity. One more definition we have said based on thermal capacity, where we have said it is a product of mass into specific heat capacity. So two types you can define, whichever you are comfortable you can remember. But remember, whenever you come across problems, if you just multiply mass into specific heat capacity, it gives a thermal capacity. Okay, so let me now just say the differences. So thermal capacity, one more, the one specific heat capacity. Specific heat capacity, you have said your definition, the amount of heat, the first point, the amount of heat required to raise, required to raise the temperature of the substance by 1 degree centigrade. Here, this can be defined as the amount of heat required to raise the temperature, required to raise the temperature per unit mass through 1 degree centigrade. So please observe, here we are using whole body, there we are using the one mass, that is per unit mass. So you are giving the heat per unit mass to raise the temperature through 1 degree centigrade. Here it mainly explains, this definition can also be defined as, this can also be defined as thermal capacity is equal to mass into specific heat. So this definition also you can remember. These both are definitions. You are need to define both the types. This. Okay. So here, in this mass into specific heat you have said. So here the SI unit is, that is SI unit for this is joules per Kelvin. Because for specific heat we have the SI unit here, where it is the SI unit for this. I'll just give the same number for this. Both are one and the same. This is for second point. This is second point, SI unit. Joules per kg per Kelvin. This is the SI unit for the one specific heat. So if you use that, here mass is there, that kg and into per kg will get cancelled, you get this. Hope you understand what I have written here in this, the one joules per kg per Kelvin. Okay, and one more point for the one writing the dimensional formula. Here in this case, where the dimensional formula for this is, third one, where it is, dimensional formula. You are ready? It is m to the power of, that is here you have specific heat. Specific heat is, that is nothing but m L square e raised to minus 2 k raised to minus 1. That is here you are writing in terms of with respect to this, here it is into this one. Dimensional formula we have here. K raised to minus 1. The power of 0. This is dimensional formula. Dimensional formula. It is m to the power of 1 L square p raised to minus 2 k raised to minus 1. How did you write this one? This already you know, isn't it? We have written the one formula for this where specific heat, where it is represented by delta Q is equal to mc delta theta, where c is equal to delta Q by m into delta theta. Q means here it is m l square t raised to minus 2 divided by m. So here you get m to the power of 0. Here it is m to the power of 0. Therefore, it is delta theta, you can write temperature T. It is, you can write T, here M into delta T is T. So, this delta gets cancelled, look at this. Hope you understand, M to the power of 0, that's for T raised to minus 2, K raised to minus 1. So, here, in this, it depends on what factors. Yesterday we have said, it depends on the mass and nature of the substance. Here we have mass and also it depends on the one mass also and the nature of the substance. Mainly depends on mass. And also you can say substance, nature of the substance. That also depends here. And here in this particularly, mainly depends on nature of the substance. Nature of the substance and temperature. I want to say today why I said this word temperature. So all substances which are possessing specific heat mainly depends on nature of the substance. Yesterday I have given example that different materials like for example iron, copper, maybe the one aluminium, all these are having different specific heat. Means it mainly depends on the nature of the material, nothing but nature of the substance. And temperature, so it also depends on temperature. As the temperature increases, specific heat slightly changes, but it also changes, it will never remain same, it changes. But that change in temperature will be very negligible, so we are neglecting that one temperature, but even then remember there will be slight change in the specific heat as and when the temperature changes. So it mainly depends on temperature as well as nature of the substance. And also you can write very simple example I want to give here, specific heat. Today I want to give example based on how specific heat is important in our day to day life. For this, I'll write the chart and in that, I'll give some substances the specific heat. Using that, I'll give an example of the one day-to-day example. Okay? Right. Now, let me just write the one chart for this. Thank you. वैसे ही टेक जाल्स पर की थी पर
water is acting as a best cooling
it absorbs more amount of heat, because already you know 4186 joules of heat is there. So as and when you want to cool any of the substance, particularly you prefer to put water on it. We'll never even put with ice also, but the size is of 2016, but compared to this water is more, so we prefer to use water for coolant purpose. So in cars you can observe where you can use this water as a coolant for radiators. So in our day-to-day examples, that is coolant purpose. For coolant purpose, that is A as radiators. In the cars, so in cars we prefer to use water as a coolant for the one radiators. It can cool because here it is having, there is more amount of specific heat, means among all these it is having highest specific heat. Highest specific heat, because of this reason we prefer to use water as a coolant, and also in this water can store large amount of heat for longer time. Without the help of radiation you can store large amount of heat, hence we prefer to use water. So by the knowledge of the specific heat, today we are able to prefer to use among all these substances, we prefer without the help of this one. This is one oil is there, ice is there, but they are very less compared to this, as per this. So we prefer to use the one water for medical purpose, and also to store large amount of heat for longer hours. That is, you can use as a, that is a pads, water pads, for where you can get the one more heat for longer hours. So I can prefer to use this one as the for the longer time. Okay, at the same time it is also used for coolant purpose. It can cool it very fast because it absorbs more amount of heat very fast as compared to other materials. Hence this is used as a one coolant, as well as for the one to absorb heat and also to reject more heat, we are using waters. Water has having highest specific heat, so we prefer to use water. Okay, so this is the one you can observe. Whenever you want to take the one water bags, water pads, you are using to, when you want to get more heat without the, when you want without the help of radiation, we can prefer this. Similarly, when you get more heat and you want to cool it very fast, means you go for the one coolant, that is water for coolant purpose, and particularly in cars we are using for radiators, right? So this is one very good example you can observe. Now, one more point I want to say, among all this, where this mercury is having lowest specific heat, where the mercury is having, this mercury is having lowest specific heat, because of this reason today we prefer to use this mercury for thermometers. Remember, suppose if you give it, will take small amount of heat to rise for larger, that is expansion will be more, even if you give slight heat for it, because it is having lowest specific heat. Hence we prefer to use in thermometers, mercury thermometers. So please observe, suppose if you have an object which is having, for example, 90 degrees centigrade, and that already that object is of 90 degrees centigrade, we are using the one thermometer to the one measure the one heat. So when you prefer to use mercury thermometer, it will absorb the one heat, and with very small amount of heat it will also, you can get the one exact value by using mercury thermometer. Because already mercury which is having the one 40 joules per kg per Kelvin, so we can measure it very easily by using the one mercury thermometer. Okay, by chance, instead of using mercury thermometer, if you use the one thermometer in which water is used, means water thermometer, at that time what happens here, remember, it the one if you are using for to measure that heat, already the water is having highest specific heat, it will never show any reading in this, because already it shows the cooling one of the one object, due to which it will never show any expansion in the thermometer. Therefore, that is, it is acting as a coolant, due to which it will not show any readings in thermometer. Hence, we prefer to use mercury thermometer rather than water thermometer. So that is the thermometer which is already filled with mercury is preferred because of lowest specific heat. It will give accurate reading, and with a small amount of heat, it will show larger expansion. Hence, it will never absorb heat from our body. It will not absorb heat. It will remain the one heat as it is. It will show the one exact reading from that. Hence, we prefer to use mercury thermometer, because this mercury thermometer, that is nothing but possesses the lowest specific heat. That is the one principle you can observe, where thermometer is having mercury thermometer shows lowest specific heat. So we prefer to use the one mercury thermometer rather than water thermometer. This example you have to remember. If you are also having special types of the one explanation for the one thermometers, but now today we are learning specific heat. With the help of specific heat, today we are able to distinguish between water thermometer and mercury thermometer, how it is useful in our day-to-day life. Rather than the water thermometer, we prefer to use mercury thermometer. Okay, so this is the one point we have to remember under the specific heat. Okay, now we also have one more specific heat in this, where we come across where we are the one using one mole of the one heat with the help, without using joules, we are using one mole of heat. So at that time we prefer to use molar specific heat capacity. So the mass used is one mole. Remember, when you come across specific heat, if you measure them in joules, different materials will have different specific heat. It will never show the exact value, because 1 kg mass will never have the same specific heat. It will be having different number of molecules for different materials. But if you prefer to use the one molar specific heat, so 1 mole in that, where you are preferring to explain, the molecules will remain same, almost all same in 1 mole of the one heat. That is nothing but when you take the substance for 1 mole, molecules will remain same. So maximum times it will be similar value for all the substances which you can explain for it. So for this, I will just draw one table. I will show the one molar specific heat capacity table. In that, you prefer to explain how you can explain the one molar specific heat for different materials, how they are same and how they are slightly different for different reasons. Okay. Now, to explain that, now let me go for the first point to explain molar specific heat. Same concept we are explaining, the amount of heat required to raise the temperature for 1 kg of mass we are saying here, but here per unit mole of mass through 1 degree centigrade. Per unit mole it is. Means you are using, instead of 1 kg, we are preferring to use 1 mole of gas, that is gas. You can also explain for different substances, and particularly for gas, you can also explain specific heat. At that time, again we have two types of specific heat for gas, because gases explains pressure, volume and temperature. Based on this, we will explain there are two types of specific heat for gases. One is specific heat capacity at constant pressure, another is specific heat capacity at constant volume. We prefer to explain them in for gases using pressure and volume. This concept you will learn in the next coming chapter, where it is thermodynamics. Also some concept you explain under the one kinetic theory of gases. So now I just explain the definition of specific heat capacity, that is particularly in terms of moles. We call it as molar specific heat. I just write the one molar specific heat. In this case, It is the amount of heat. It is the amount of heat. Amount of heat required to raise. Required to raise the temperature. Of 1 mole of substance.
Monotony.
gas, tritonic gases. There you come across this concept. Again, in the thermodynamics chapter, we also prefer to use Cp and Cv to explain the concept of thermodynamics. So, in the next coming days you come across, at present remember, so if you explain specific heat, particularly in terms of moles, we speak molar specific heat capacity. If you are placing pressure constant for a gas, then you call it as molar specific heat capacity at constant pressure. If you are keeping volume constant, molar specific heat capacity at constant volume. Okay, so this you are familiar now, you just remember these things, it is enough. But now, I just want to say one point here, how this balance will vary, because in the next coming chapter you will have molar specific heat at constant pressure and molar specific heat at constant volume you have. Now I will just write the one table for this, you will understand much better for that. What do you want to say here means, here it is Cp, one more Cv here. For helium, it is 20.8 and this is 12.5. For hydrogen, it is 28.8 and this is 20.4. For nitrogen, it is 29.1. 20.8. For oxygen, it is 29.4. It is 21.1. Carbon dioxide, it is 37. It is 28.5. So what do you want to see even in this case means, they have given separated tables for this, where constant pressure and this is for constant volume. Now if you observe the values, here these are the gases, wherein gases you come across monatomic, diatomic and tritonic gases that you learn in the next coming chapter. At present in this if you observe, this hydrogen, nitrogen and oxygen, these three are called as diatomic. They are called as diatomic. For these three you can observe, the value lies between 20 to 21. In this range you will get it. Almost all similar for different materials, different substances. The one for diatomic gas, it is almost all similar it is. Means which are nearer to this one. It rises only between 20 and 21. Okay. If you come across, this is helium, which is monatomic gas. This is monatomic. Where for this we come across, it is 12.5. For monatomic. If you come across for carbon dioxide, which is tritonic gas, where it is 28.5. So these values you again learn in the next coming chapter. At present, just you observe, almost all it remains same means, because if you take one mole of the one gas, one mole, the molecules which are present in one mole are always same. They are not different, they are same. But when you come across specific heat, if you take 1 kg of the one substance and the molecules slightly they differ for different substances. But here different substances are there, but all the three are diatomic gas. But one mole of the one substance you have, but the molecules are nearly similar, almost all same here, due to which you can observe the one how the vary in the readings. So please remember, the specific heat slightly varies from substance to substance. Because of 1 kg substance you are preferring, but the molecule slightly varies from substance to substance. But this will never vary in one mole of the substance where you, the one molecules will remain same in one mole. At the same time, in specific heat, the one specific heat varies as the temperature changes. If the temperature rises slightly, the specific heat also varies, but slightly it varies, say, which cannot be noticed. Because slightly temperature rises, that is negligible, that you can also observe under specific heat. Now, specific heat varies with temperature. Okay, so today we have learnt some chart and also we have learnt today one more concept called molar specific heat. And molar specific heat, there you also have learnt how diatomic, tritonic values will be similar to it. For different substances also, how those will vary. At the same time, under molar specific heat, are learned two types of molar specific heat for a gas. One is Cp, another is Cv. What is Cp? Molar specific heat capacity at constant pressure. Cv, molar specific heat capacity at constant volume. But how do you represent them? You are representing by capital C subscript P for constant pressure. If it is constant volume, capital C subscript 2. By chance, if you want to write specific heat in terms of C, you have to represent by small c. This point you just remember when you come across the one conditions here. Okay, now this completes the one specific heat along with molar specific heat. We have also highlighted thermal capacity. Okay,
right.
Now the next concept you come across, one more called as calorimetry. This calorimetry is an instrument used to measure heat. It's a device used to measure heat. So let me explain how the one heat we are explaining. Particularly calorimetry is used to measure specific heat. I prefer to explain to measure heat we are using the instrument called calorimetry, but specifically we can explain to measure specific heat. Also we can, the extent we can also measure latent heat also can be measured by using calorimetry. Okay, right. Now let me go for the one instrument, is one concept called as calorimetry. Nutritious, that is nutritious. electricians will explain the one amount of heat, that is nothing but calories, the food what we take, that is measured in terms of energy. Whatever we want to get energy, the whatever the intake we take as a food that gives us energy, that will be explained in terms of calories. So the nutritionists will explain about the one called as the one energies in terms of calories. So most of the time you can observe this much amount of calories of heat, the energy is required for our body. That is how they explain. The one dietitians you can explain. Dietitians will explain this much amount of heat to be, that is energy should be taken to your body. That will be in terms of calories they will explain. You already know the higher order of calories is kilocalories. Because higher order of calories is measured in kilocalories. So they explain, even the one, the dietitians will explain them in terms of nutritions, you can explain them in kilocalories. So they explain them in higher orders. Okay, so that is the point to remember. Now, to explain this calorimetry, where I said it's a measurement of heat, we explain. Particularly the heat, what we measure is, particularly we explain the one specific heat. So specific heat is particularly measured by the instrument called as a calorimeter. Also, at some extent, we also measure the one latent heats. In the next coming class, I will explain about latent heat. There, that can also be measured by using the one instrument called calorimeter. Okay, to explain this, where you can also observe, this explains one principle. What that principle means? Always heat transfers from higher temperature to lower temperature. Always heat flows from higher body to lower body. Always from higher temperature to lower temperature. Provided there is no loss notice of heat to the surroundings. That is the one principle you can observe here. So you can explain heat transfer. Always heat transfer from higher temperature to lower temperature. Lower temperature. Always heat flows from higher temperature to lower temperature. Provided there is no loss of heat. There is no loss of heat. Loss of heat to the surroundings. Loss of heat to the surroundings. This concept we have to observe. So heat transfers from higher temperature to lower temperature, provided there is no loss of heat to the surroundings. That is the one concept we observe in calorimeter. Okay. So at the same time, on which principle it is explained? The calorimeter means it always explains the conservation of energy. That uses the principle of conservation of energy. The principle behind this is conservation of energy. Conservation of energy. You can say that is neither heat is lost, neither heat is gained. There is no, that it transfers from one form to another form. But remember here, it is conserved. That is conservation of energy principle is used here. That is another one calorimeter. Okay. What, on which principle you are explaining is conservation of energy. At the same time, it explains one principle. What is the principle of calorimetry? Means very simple point. Heat lost is always equal to heat gain. That is the one principle you come across. That is heat lost is equal to heat gain. This principle we are using under the one calorimeter. So whatever the heat is lost, that will be heat is gained. So if you observe, if you take, for example, a cup of tea which is placed on the table. A cup of tea is there. Along with that you have one more ice water. Right? Ice water is there. So here one is hot, one is cold. So what happens? Always heat flows from higher temperature to lower temperature. How much time it will flow? Unless heat both will become equivalent. Means both will explain thermal equilibrium. Both will attain the same temperature. Until then, heat flows from higher temperature to lower temperature. So you should be familiar that how does heat flows? Heat flows from higher temperature to lower temperature. Up to what time? Until it attains the same temperature. Until it maintains equal temperature. Until then, it will be flowing. When once it gains the same temperature, both then it will stop. The flowing of heat will be stopped. That is how it maintains thermal equilibrium. Heat flows from one point to another point and from one end to another end until it gains the same temperature. So you can observe it maintains thermal equilibrium. Until it maintains thermal equilibrium. So here you can observe that is the one concept of calorimetry and how it explains here the one temperature. And remember here main concept is measurement of heat is it. And we have an instrument called as calorimeter, and that calorimeter where you can explain the one here heat transfer from higher temperature to lower temperature provided there is no loss of heat to the surroundings. That should not lose any amount of heat from it. Has to transfer from one end point to another point. At the same time, you know the one principle behind this is conservation of energy. It uses the concept of conservation of energy. What does it explain? Heat loss is always equal to heat gain. How much loss will be there and how much gain will be? It will be flowing from one end to the another, one body to another body until it maintains thermal equilibrium. These are the concepts you come across here. For this, I'll explain the practical device how we use in the laboratory. So that instrument, how it will be, how heat will be measured. That experiment, let me show you by drawing the figure, and also I'll show the one how it will be there. The one calorimetry, what are the contents are there, how heat will be gained, and how heat will be lost. But at the same time, there is no loss of heat. Transfer of heat will be there. But there is no loss of heat will be there. That also I will show in the next class. Okay, let me stop here. So please remember, this is the one concept you come across in the calorimeter. And the principle process we call it as, this is calorimetry. The process of measurement of heat is called calorimetry. The instrument we are using is calorimeter. This I will draw the figure and I will explain how there is no loss of heat when the one heat transfers from one point to another point. That explains along with figure one experiment which we do in our laboratory and how we measure the one temperatures and how we write the formula for this. I'll write in the